Merci. Bonjour Paris, bonjour France. Je m'appelle Terence Khawaja. Je suis né au Québec et ma langue maternelle était le français. But you wouldn't know it. I haven't spoken the language in over 50 years, so you'll have to put up with my English. Sorry. Okay, so I have a very fun topic to talk to you about today, which is the year that was 2021. Une année Madtech. And what a year it was. And so we're going to sort of talk about what was, perhaps make some comparisons to a not too distant past when things weren't as good. You know, we just had Thanksgiving in the U.S. We can probably give some thanks for where we are today versus then, and then maybe think about where we're likely to head in the future. So perhaps the first question that could be on your minds is, at an ad tech conference, why are you listening to an investment banker? After all, we don't have the best reputations. Oh. Yeah. So I wake up every morning knowing this is what people think of me. So, but perhaps we do know something about ad tech. We have intermediated quite a number of transactions. In fact, at the end of this year, we will have intermediated over $25 billion in exits for ad tech entrepreneurs. So that's worth something, I suppose. But we not only take our deals seriously, we take our presentation themes seriously. So we're prolific. We have a great relationship with the IAB and the MMA, and we've made many presentations about what's going on in the sector. But we also like to have some fun, so we've done music videos, parody videos that try and highlight some of the issues that are going on in the industry, because you always have to have lots of ways to be able to communicate. And we'll hear a little bit about some of those a little bit later on. So let's see, this year, so many things happening. We're going to talk about the incredible stock valuations, the IPOs, the SPACs, the strategic M&A and private equity activity that was 2021, and quite a year it was. So if you look at MadTech, you know, valuations, they are the best performing tech categories. I mean, the S&P is up 50% in the year since January 2020, since just before the pandemic, and yet AdTech and MarTech have gone up 3 or 4 fold. They are leading the pack in terms of stock market performance and valuations, which of course has led companies to take their company public on the stock exchanges. We've had 13 regular way IPOs in 2021, raising $8 billion in capital. That represents over $100 billion worth of market cap that did not exist this time last year. Pretty incredible numbers. And then factoring in SPACs, we had 4 SPACs particular to the ad tech and MarTech world, one of which, Innovid, started trading today on the New York Stock Exchange under the ticker CTV, imagine. And so that brings a total of 17 new public companies just this year, which is really, really incredible. Not only that, we've seen M&A activity, really, it just took a slight break during COVID in 2020 in Q2 and Q3, but came raging back, and you can see the quarters since, and even the fourth quarter, if you standardize it for the rest of the quarter, we've seen almost 350 M&A deals since the onset of the pandemic. That's not something I necessarily would have predicted. And of course, they're happening across strategic. Largely, these are falling in categories like CTV, mobile app monetization, and commerce media, 3 trends we're going to be talking about further. Not only that, we have seen private equity come into this sector. Let's remember that the investment community was largely avoiding ad tech, in part because they didn't like the valuations of the public companies. Well, we solved that, as you saw in the previous slide. but also because many of the companies in the sector simply weren't mature enough. They didn't have the kind of profitability and sustainability attributes that private equity looks for in deals. And yet, this year, we've seen multiple multi-billion dollar deals. And it's not as though this class of private equity investor is coming in at a low multiple of cash flow and looking to cut costs. No, they're coming in with a very much of a growth mindset where in some instances they're paying 10, 12, 15 times revenue. Private equity paying double-digit multiples of revenue. So they're really very much acting like strategics. But it wasn't always this good. And to hearken back to sort of how things were, say, 4 years ago, I made a video along the lines, I made three videos along the lines of Les Miserables. And this one really does sort of sadly portray the state of the industry at that time.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
That's me singing.
When stocks were high and spend was thriving. I dreamed ad tech would never die. I dreamed take rates would not be diving. When I was on my Series A, business plans were made and used and wasted. With might, taking all the growth like plunder as they tear your yield apart and consolidate the scale.
Okay, there we go. A little bit of Hollywood for your morning. But by the way, that was my executive assistant Susan Marshall, amazing talent. But let's put this in 2021 in perspective. If we go back to 2017, there were only a handful of public companies that had market caps over 100 million. And in fact, there was a grand total of $7 billion of market cap of all of these companies. The whole industry amounted to $7 billion in public companies trading at two times revenue. So pretty paltry results. Fast forward 4 years, and today, 23 public companies with, as you saw, more on the way, $250 billion in market cap and an average revenue multiple of over 13. It is night and day the difference that has transpired in this industry in the last 4 years. We constructed an index. There are now a sufficient number of public companies in both ad tech and martech that we constructed indices called the Luma Index, the Luma A and the Luma M Index, where we track these companies back to Jan 1, 2017, where we track their performance and compared again to the industry, these things have massively outperformed. In fact, this is part of a trend where all tech or innovation companies have over the pandemic, they have gapped out. Compare the tech-centric companies on the left and the non-tech-centric companies on the right. And take a look at those valuations. Not only are they trading at higher valuations, but over the course of the pandemic, from January 2020 to today, not only are they trading higher, they gapped up and are trading higher even still. and the two sectors, again, leading the pack in terms of not only the highest multiples, but the highest increase in valuation over that time period is ad tech and martech companies. And part of the rationale, yes, we're going to talk about some of the accelerants that transpired during the pandemic, but in part, this is investors sort of having a rethink about the nature of revenues that an advertising technology company has. They're obviously, unlike SaaS, you know, the reason why investors love SaaS is because they're contractually recurring revenues. And that was the knock on transaction revenues from advertising, that it's not contractually recurring. But it turns out that if your net revenue retention is greater than 100%, it may not be contractually recurring, but it is de facto reoccurring. And the market, largely driven by companies like Snowflake, that made this particular case to investors that we are not a SaaS company, nor do we want to be a SaaS company, because that would limit our growth, is if you're in a high-growth transactional revenue model, then turns out, so long as you're handling net revenue retention properly, you can get those valuations. And as you're seeing, in multiples in 13, 14, 15 are clearly on top of where people value SaaS revenue. And we're describing this market as achieving both breadth and depth. And by that, we mean this follows. So breadth is just the pure fact that transactions are occurring in every type. So we talked about, you know, valuations and IPOs and SPACs and M&A. We've got a mad tech middle class, finally, and then new entrants. What I mean by middle class is, you know, whether you're talking society or industry, it's always a bad construct to have only a few rich elites. Think about, you know, walled gardens whose count their market cap in trillions, and then smaller, you know, private companies. Today, same thing is true in industry, and today we have 37 companies across ad tech and martech with market caps in excess of $1 billion. This is a true middle class, and it matters, because these companies will be doing, you know, deals to grow, and they'll be driving investor returns, so that you don't have to just choose between duopoly or triopoly and then private companies. This is makes for a healthy ecosystem. And With both the privacy constraints and the data deprecation from Apple and Google, basically any company with a large amount of consumer data is discovering that they can launch an ad business. So if I were to tell you that companies like Apple, Instacart, Uber, Zoom, Zynga, DoorDash are going to be in the ad tech business, you'd have scratched your head. But like, you know, 6 months ago, and sure enough, they're all flooding into the industry. So having a middle class and having new entrants into the sector makes for very healthy dynamics. And then depth. And we say this is a market with depth because, as it turns out, not only is the digital ad marketplace growing, it's growing at 20%, it's large, right? Massive to start with. It's growing at 20%, and in fact, it's inflecting up. The latest e-marketer forecasts have had to adjust upward the growth of this already large market. So it's the TAM is increasing even faster. And of these new companies that have gone public, they're all reporting their quarterly results, and the vast majority of them are beating their numbers. They're beating expectations and guiding upwards. And of course, that again brings depth to this positive news. So, where is the action? We would suggest something we call the pandemic trifecta. Over the course of the pandemic, we saw three areas really take off: gaming, streaming, and e-commerce. These were three sectors that were doing well before the pandemic, but they inflected up during COVID. So just a little bit on each one of these. So the gaming slash mobile app world is on fire. Gaming is a massive marketplace and growing rapidly. Those numbers have been adjusted upwards. And gaming has fundamentally changed. Now over 50% of all gaming is taking place right here on the mobile phone. Now, that's leading to all kinds of ad opportunities, right? A lot more inventory. And you're seeing an inflection up in the massive, already massive, mobile ad spend. You can see the 2021 growth spiked up as a function of that inflection during the pandemic. And you're seeing it's driving both vertical and horizontal M&A. You're seeing the ad tech companies buy gaming, so they're going O&O, going vertical, and vice versa. Companies like Zynga buying into ad tech, and as well as horizontal mergers to take advantage of that market opportunity. Second is streaming. There's, of course, audio streaming. Small market, growing nicely. We're excited about it, but even bigger is CTV. Look, here, the premise is to take the attributes of digital, of targeting, personalization, attribution, and performance, and apply them to the big screen, where the there's a lot of dollars. And if you think about it, right, it's you've got a sort of like a spectrum. CBS, one of the leading broadcasters in the United States, has a grand total of 200 advertisers. Facebook has 10 million. So if you put those on either end of the spectrum, what essentially what opening up the TV media channel to smaller advertisers that can take advantage of targeting, which heretofore could not have afforded the channel, it essentially democratizes TV ad spend. And yet it's not a simple construct, right? You've got linear, addressable, OTT, and digital video that all have their own identity parameters, their own workflow, their own dynamic ad serving technologies. And so what is needed on behalf of the marketer is they have to think about this channel holistically and be able to manage campaigns across these four sub-channels of CTV, because they need unified, standardized measurement to be able to plan by analyze and attribute advertising. And I think what you're seeing play out in the US today with NBC running an RFP to change their measurement vendors is a reflection of that very need. And of course, it's a huge market in the US. It's already over $100 billion market, where the major shift is to go from linear to OTT. But it's already over 50% addressable. So large, growing, and addressable market. And then finally, commerce media, one that we think has a great opportunity. Think about it. The e-commerce marketplace globally is a $5 trillion market, and it really spiked up over the pandemic, as you might imagine, as everyone started ordering from home. Well, think about now the media that leads to that e-commerce commerce conversion. So in the US, e-commerce penetration was growing nicely and steadily to about 15% penetration pre-COVID. And then it spiked up to 25%. Well, what are the implications on media? Essentially, you have to do portfolio rebalancing, because all of the ad spend allocations above the line and marketing spend below the line were factored on a world that was 85-15, 85 retail, 15 e-commerce. And now that's a 75-25 world. And so if you sort of just run some rough numbers, assuming, again, this is all sort of US domestic, $500 billion of ad spend above the line, 300 below, that's $800 billion, 10% of which has to be reallocated to channels that convert in an e-commerce context. And so that's an $80 billion shift in spend that has to largely take place overnight. We're calling this trend from end caps to mobile apps. And we think this is going to have a massive advantage for digital and for people with first-party data, ergo the huge opportunity in commerce media. And all you got to do is look at Amazon. They're going to be a $30 billion media company this year, $30 billion in media, because they have closed loop on data. They've demonstrated the efficacy and the efficiency of spend, and they're growing rapidly and making a lot of money, which is why almost every other retailer has launched their own ad network in almost military-like precision. Yep, they're just coming in one after another, announcing their own retail media initiatives. And let's not forget, for any retailer not large enough to launch their own, there is, of course, how can one... Hey, listen, jingoism doesn't only apply to the United States. Come on, we can be pro-France here. All right, so what... But and yet, there of course, there are threats and challenges. You're obviously imminently familiar with the privacy regulation. And more important than just the regulation is the enforcement. Because here in Europe, they take regulation seriously compared to California. And so, you know, your local authorities are, you know, jacking up fines and bringing real teeth to these consent requirements. Appropriate, right? If you're going to do regulation, you may as well enforce it. But it's having a big impact, and so I think we're going to continue to have to deal with the challenges of privacy constraints as the cookie deprecation becomes a reality. And perhaps even bigger than that, and you'll hear from this in excruciatingly amazing detail, the smartest person on the case of Apple, ATT, and the whole data deprecation is Eric Seufert. So I'm glad he's going to be able to speak with you. But this, in particular in France, when you consider the 85% market share of Chrome and Safari, is a very big deal. So cookie deprecation, one thing. ATT, perhaps even more impactful in terms of limiting those signals from third parties. Therefore, clearly, the import on first-party data. And again, if privacy regulations and consent frameworks are something to contend with, driving people towards first-party data, guess what? Again, everyone becomes an ad network. Every large consumer data company with large consumer data pools will, of course, launch their own ad network. And the risk here is that we end up with balkanization, silos of data in certain places that is not in the sort of open internet, open web, open marketplaces. Now, there are solutions to that. We've seen the rise of clean rooms, and I think we're going to see a lot more technologies to be able to address this potential balkanization problem. So, outlook for the future, I've got like just a couple of high-level things to point out. One is, and I've been a long-time believer in this notion, is that we as an industry need to migrate towards performance, away from impression and other proxies and towards business outcomes. The more we can create solutions for advertisers that really drive to what they're looking for in the very first instance. The reason they open their wallet and spend on advertising and marketing is in order to affect better business outcomes. And the better we can facilitate that, I think it has multiple advantages. Advantage number one, and this is massive, it mitigates many of the supply challenges that we've been facing in this industry. I mean, Tony Katzer every day has to deal with issues about fraud and viewability and transparency and all these issues that advertisers, you know, scream at ad tech saying, hey, how come you're not fixing these problems? Well, guess what? In a world where we're delivering business outcomes, impressions doesn't matter if it was fraud. Last time I checked, bots don't purchase goods and services. So we don't have to worry about fraud. We don't have to worry about viewability in a world where we migrate away from those proxies. Second, of course, this does require measurement and attribution. So there will be a technology element required here. Third, and this is a really, really, really important one, it increases the operating leverage of your intermediary business. And makes it more resilient. I'm going to talk more about that operating leverage here right now. So some advertisers, you know, you've heard of the direct-to-consumer brands and certainly the mobile app players that intermediate based on an install. They charge on an install basis. They take a very different approach to advertising spend. They think of it as a science, not an art. They think of it in terms of math. What do we have to spend X in order to get Y revenue? And their math is customer acquisition costs versus lifetime value. And it's very formulaic. I mean, they're very scientific about this. And so in their minds, the notion of spending on advertising is less about a discretionary expense and more of a cost of goods sold. So in a way, you could say they've moved it up the income statement towards cost of goods sold. They don't even call the person in charge of media spend at a direct-to-consumer company a chief marketing officer. They call them a chief growth officer because they think of spend purely in the context of driving growth. And we've seen this from the purists in this space, the most sophisticated marketers in terms of performance. You know, we saw it in gaming, and then the other app install companies, and then direct to consumer. And I am quite certain that these will end up being the canary in the coal mine that will lead other marketers to follow the same path. Am I saying that everyone goes to direct response? No, but I believe there will be a blend where they will certainly impose some of the beneficial approaches that these performance marketers have taken towards their spend in order to ensure that they're driving growth. The second point I want to leave you with is this notion of taking a bigger picture view of sort of what we're trying to accomplish here. I think that so far ad tech has really been sort of focused on efficiency, and it's great that there's a global marketing TAM of over $2 trillion, but with so much of it around sort of marginally improving spend or return, I think the focus has been on efficiency, when in reality, I think we're going to find that there's far more opportunity on the efficacy front. And that's where I think we're going to see the re-rise of creative in ad tech. Because to the extent you can improve efficacy, it's far better than, you know, saving a few dollars on efficiency. So, you know, cheaper is good, but better is, better. So I think that's a mindset that the industry needs to adopt. And then you know, finally, in May, I wrote a guest column in AdExchanger entitled "Prepare for the Mother of All M&A Booms." Now, I suppose, you know, when you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So to an M&A advisor, sure, calling for more M&A sounds logical. But I laid out sort of eight elements that I thought would drive this, from economic recovery, digital acceleration, the changing identity, floor plates, triopoly headwinds. My gosh, that has done, you know, just the antitrust action, even though it may not result in anything, has already benefited the industry by driving spend and focus to smaller players, ergo the middle class, you know, the private equity, the corporate restructurings that are going on, the currency of these new public companies being able to transact, and the competition. We said that would drive a tremendous amount of M&A. Well, just since May, we've seen a ton of M&A, so I think you could sort of, you know, go through each one of these and say, yeah, we pretty much nailed it. And I think this is a good, yeah, sure, that's great for M&A advisors, but having an active, robust transaction environment for an industry is always healthy, because that means that there are optionality. There's buying, there's selling, and going public. And by the way, I before I get on to my final item, I often get asked about new trends, and boy, the marketing industry loves the shiny new object, and so every little thing that comes along, I tend to be a bit of a naysayer on all this new stuff. And the latest one, of course, is the metaverse. Everyone asks me, hey, what is going to be the near-term opportunity in the advertising industry for the metaverse? Well, let's just go and have a look, shall we? This is the Metascape VR. Here we go. look for our answer. Hey, Mark.
Certainement pas.
No, no. Answer is no. It's not going to happen. Not going to happen. So don't spend time on it. Finally. So again, we've come a long way. So I'm going to take you back 4 years ago, a little over 4 years ago. An industry organization honored me with a Lifetime Achievement Award in ad tech. And I thought, what should my acceptance speech say? And I thought, well, rather than just writing an acceptance speech, I made a piece of creative. And what I wanted to reflect on was, if you could turn your mind back 4.5 years ago, the mindset was terrible, right? Everyone thought ad tech was evil, and we were going in the wrong direction, and the future was hopeless. And I thought, I don't really think that, but I tell you what, let's create this, make this creative. So here we go.
I strongly believe ad tech is doomed. And why would we ever think that data is the key to marketing success? We need to acknowledge that consumers benefit from targeted personalized advertising is a lie, and mass advertising still works best for brands. So at the next industry conference, I will tell the audience they don't know what they're talking about. Naysayers of the sector say that, again, impressions are more important than results. The people in this room will tell you relevancy matters, but this is not true. Data is devaluing advertising. Some people say that 5 years from now, Google and Facebook will be the only players. I honestly do not think that there is hope for the Lumascape. In the future, ad tech will cease to matter, and it cannot be said that marketers are well served by technology. It will be evident that programmatic advertising is not the future, and it is foolish to presume that companies in the sector will continue to achieve exits. And this will all come true if we don't reverse our thinking. Companies in the sector will continue to achieve exits, and it is foolish to presume that programmatic advertising is not the future. It will be evident that marketers are well served by technology, and it cannot be said that ad tech will cease to matter. In the future, there is hope for the Lumascape. I honestly do not think that 5 years from now, Google and Facebook will be the only players. Some people say that data is devaluing advertising, but this is not true. Relevancy matters. People in this room will tell you results are more important than impressions. Say that again. Naysayers of the sector, they don't know what they're talking about. So at the next industry conference, I will tell the audience mass advertising still works best for brands is a lie, and consumers benefit from targeted, personalized advertising. We need to acknowledge that data is the key to marketing success. And why would we ever think that ad tech is doomed? I strongly believe.
So,
bravo.
As it turns out, it's just a function of perspective. So with that, I thank you.